Because of the inclement weather, we're not going to have Q&A.
God, we give you the glory.
Yes, Lord.
God, we give you the honor. God, we give you every bit of our praise. Because you alone deserve it. You alone are worthy. You alone. Come on, and if you know that to be true, lift up your voice and just begin to thank him right now all over this building. Come on, open up your mouth and begin to thank your Father. Yeah. Clap your hands, clap, 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 clap. Here we go. Say. Yes, sir. Can y'all join in and help us with that?
Finish the work to make me new. Breeze in my life is a sacrifice.
It's the least I can do.
It's the least I can do.
Say.
You gave it all for me. Now I'm free to live for you.
Said, finish the work.
Finish the work. Just to give me
way back on Calvary.
Just to give me
you did it for me. comes, he will cover the situation that you're going through. It may not be the way that you want it, but understand that he sent his son to die just for me. And if that's another, if that's the only reason I have to praise, if that's the only reason I have to open up my mouth, that's the only reason I have to lift my hands, is knowing that he sent his son to die for old reckless me. I'm not even perfect enough, but he said, you are perfect enough for me, for my son to die for you. So we lift our hands and say, you left heaven just to get me.
Just to get me there.
You left heaven.
You left heaven.
Just to get me there.
Just to get me there.
Since you left heaven. Just to get me there.
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 You push past what you see.
Just to get me there.
It came for me.
Just to get me
there. When others gave up on me.
Just to get me.
You said, here come up my turn.
Just to get me.
Just to get me there.
Just to get me there.
Just to get me.
Just to get me there.
Yes, he did. Yes, he did.
Just to get me there.
Yes, he did. Yes, he did.
Just to get me there.
Can we lift our hands together all over this building? Come on, just begin to lift your hands all over this place right now. Come on, if you have hands, lift your hands. We want to say how he is awesome, how he is amazing. Even though we don't see it, even though we feel like, yo, things are not the way that I want them to be, I still know that you're an amazing God.
Yeah.
Yeah. Let's just together. Said, how great is our God? So sing with me how. Come on, it's our God. All will see. Come on, sing it like you're really singing to a great God. It's our God. Come on, would you say that right for a little bit more? Come on, that's together. We say, how great, say.
How great
is our God. Sing with me.
Sing with me, how great
is our God. Said, how great,
how great
is our God.
Is our God.
Sing with me, with me.
Sing with me, how great
is our God.
Is our God.
Oh, we'll see.
Oh, we'll see how great.
We'll see how great he is.
How great
is our God.
Is our God.
Yes, Father, we thank you. We thank you for being awesome in all your ways. You're the name. Said, you're the
name.
Come on, sing it real loud. You're worthy.
You are worthy of all praise.
And our hearts will sing.
And our hearts will sing. How great
is our God.
Is our God.
One more time. Said, you're the name above our name.
You're the name above all names.
Said, you are worthy. Band real fast. Said, how great, no music. It's our God. Sing with me.
Ooh.
All we'll see.
Yeah,
Yahweh, Yahweh, Yahweh. It's our God. One more time. One more time. Said, you're the name. Say, said, you're the. Yeah, sounds so good to hear. Said, you are worthy.
You are worthy of
said, in our hearts we'll sing.
Our hearts will sing.
It's our God.
It's our God.
Come on now, just begin to thank your God right now. Just begin to thank him all over this place in your own way. When there's no music, when there's nobody leading you on, begin to thank your Father right now. Come on, talk to your daddy right now. God, I thank you for new mercies. I thank you for a new day. I thank you for life, health, and strength. I thank you for being Yahweh. I thank you for being Alpha and Omega. I thank you for being my provider, Jehovah Rapha. I thank you for being a way maker. I thank you for being the beginning and the end. I thank you for being my daddy. I thank you for being my corrector. I thank you for being my structure. I thank you for being consistent. Yeah, begin to thank him for what he is in your life. Yeah. Come on, I hear somebody, he's a promise keeper. I hear somebody saying he's a promise keeper. Come on, I hear somebody saying he's a healer. I hear someone saying he's a deliverer. I hear someone saying he's a way maker. I hear someone saying he's a marriage resurrector. I hear someone saying that he kills, he breaks every chain of affliction. I hear him saying that you destroy pornography. I hear him. That's the type of God he is. He'll never leave you. He'll never forsake you. But he said, I'll be with you until the end. When everybody else leaves you, he said, I'm not going anywhere, but I'm staying right here. I'm actually in front of you, calling you to me. Come be with me, my child. Come be with me, my son. Come be with me, my daughter. If you know that to be true, open up your mouth and begin to thank your Father. Begin to thank Yahweh. Begin to thank Jehovah Rapha. Come on, let's stay right there for a little bit. Come on, let's begin to salute our God. Come on, begin to salute your King. I wish I had about 50 people that would just do something that they're not used to doing. I wish I had some people that would run if they feel like running. Jump if you feel like jumping. Scream if you feel like screaming. Shout if you feel like shouting. But everything that has breath, begin to release it right now.
Come on, one more time. Just lift up your voice and scream in the room.
Yay! Yeah.
Real simple song we want to teach you. So it says,
Yahweh.
Hey.
Yahweh.
Yes, sir.
Hey, be praised.
Yes, Lord.
Yahweh.
Come on, if you know, sing it. Say,
Yahweh.
Come on here, Yahweh.
Yahweh.
Say, be praised.
Be praised.
Yahweh.
Yahweh.
I want to hear y'all. Yahweh. Say,
Yahweh.
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 Come on, clap your hands. Be praised. Say,
be praised.
Yahweh.
Yahweh.
Come on. Everybody clap your hands. Say,
Yahweh.
Say, Yahweh. Say,
and full of wonders,
you say, come on.
God,
Yahweh,
Yahweh,
real big, say Yahweh.
Yes, sir.
Yahweh,
Yahweh,
say be praised.
Be praised.
Yahweh,
Yahweh,
we call you Yahweh.
Yahweh,
be praised.
Yahweh,
be praised.
Be praised.
Yahweh,
Yahweh.
Matchless power,
infinite.
Yahweh. Can you clap your hands and say that? Come on, say. Say Yahweh, say. Be praised.
Be praised.
Yahweh. Come on, real strong. Say Yahweh. Say, be praised, Yahweh. See Yahweh. Yeah. Hey, be praised,
Yahweh.
Now somebody celebrate Yahweh. Come on, I dare you to scream in the room and celebrate your Savior. I tell you to lift up the name of Yahweh. Lift up the name of Jesus. Come on, real strong one more time. Say Yahweh.
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 Be praised.
Yahweh. Oh, my Yahweh.
Yahweh.
Be praised. And praise your Father. Say,
be praised.
One more time, let's lift it up real strong. Say, yeah.
Be praised.
Be praised.
Be praised.
Be praised. We praise you, our King.
Be praised.
We praise you, our King.
Be praised.
With everything that have breath.
Be praised.
With everything that have breath.
Be praised.
With everything that have breath.
Be praised.
With everything that have breath. Sing it real strong. Say, Yahweh, will you be praised? Yahweh, Yahweh, say, be exalted, oh God. Be praised. Yahweh, just lift your hands and say, be praised. Yeah. Yes, Lord.
Be praised.
Yes, God.
Yahweh.
Come on, somebody tell him, be praised.
Be praised.
It takes faith to worship
Yahweh.
The way you're worshiping today.
Be
because I know you got issues at home.
Yahweh.
But he must still be praised.
Be praised.
I know you've got sickness in your body.
Yahweh.
But he must still be praised.
Be praised.
I know you're still waiting on something.
Yahweh.
But he must still be praised. Say,
be praised.
Yahweh.
Yahweh.
Be praised.
Be praised.
Yahweh.
Yahweh.
So we lift you. We lift you high. Come on, you say it.
Yahweh, Yahweh.
Look up. So we lift you high. I want to hear you say
it. Yahweh, Yahweh.
Yes, Lord. So we lift you high. Yahweh.
Yahweh.
Can you do something real quick? Can you just lift your hands and say, so we lift you, yeah, high. All over this house, say,
Yahweh.
Yeah. The Holy Spirit is in this room, so we lift you. Yes, so we give you worship, Yahweh.
Yahweh, Yahweh.
Come on, I dare you to surrender all that you are to Yahweh. We lift you up.
Keeping God.
let's just say that. See, you are loving and keeping good. We bow in your presence,
Yahweh.
Want to sing songs, but we want your presence. We want your glory. So for the next moment, without us singing any song or without us giving you any instruction, I just want you to do what you know you were born and created to do. And if you're a being in this room that God has breathed into, you should already know what your responsibility is in this atmosphere. God, I don't want to just be a singer standing in front of people, but we want to be vessels. God, we thank you for your presence. Come on, just begin to speak to him all over this room. Listen to your glory.
The music just play a little softer right now, because the Holy Spirit is definitely in the room. And when the Holy Spirit is present, you gotta bow down and acknowledge his presence. We worship you, Father. We thank you, Father. We thank you for meeting us right where we are. Thank you for ministering to bodies right now, touching hearts and touching minds. Oh, worry, you can't stay in this place. Fear. No more can you reside here. Thank you, Holy Spirit. We acknowledge your presence today. I want you to take about 20 seconds to just no longer focus on your problems. Don't worry about what's going on in your house. Don't worry about your situation on your job. Don't even worry about your wife. Don't worry about your kids right now, because we're going to totally give all that to him. And I want you to focus on him. Because when you can focus on him, then he can begin to focus on what's going on in your life. I don't even want you to look at me. Don't look at me. Don't look up here. Just, I want you to close your eyes, and I want you to lift your hands, and I want you to take 20 seconds. That's all I'm, just 20 seconds, and focus on him. I want you to begin to just lift your heads up, and now I want you to put a big smile on your face, because whenever you allow the Lord to get invited into what's going on in your life, now you can smile again. So now those frowns should turn into smiles. All that fear should have left you, and now love has gotten a hold. Love has gotten a hold of your children. Oh, come on, there's some parents out there. I'm talking to you. Oh, love has gotten a hold of your husband. Come on, wives, that's your time right now to begin to call out his name. Oh, love is taking care of your wife. Come on, husbands, get out of their face and begin to get into his face. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, love is taking a hold of your body right now. Thank you, dear God. Hallelujah. Father, we give you honor and we give you praise because you are Yahweh, the creator of the universe. You created us. You know all about us. You know how we work. And when we malfunction, God, we thank you that we can give you full control in the name of Jesus. We're having our spiritual oil check today. Aha! Yeah, yeah. And when the word comes forth, Father, we'll hear what you say and not what the preacher says. Oh, Father, we thank you right now that we're preparing our hearts so that it can be confirmed by the man of God as he speaks spiritual things into our lives. And so, Father, we thank you for what you've already done, and we've created an environment for the Holy Spirit to dwell. Oh, come on, somebody. If you want him to dwell here, you need to begin to thank him for what he's doing in your life. Oh, come on, somebody. Thank him because he's a good and faithful God. Come on, somebody, if you know what I'm talking about today, I need you to open up your mouth and give him your biggest thanks today.
For being faithful and mighty in my life. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Come on, just give him one more big shout of praise. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for another opportunity. Thank you for another day. Thank you for another chance. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you that I'm not dead. Thank you that I'm still alive. Yeah. Thank you, Father God, that my body still works. Thank you, God, that you have a plan and a purpose for my family and my marriage and my children and my children's children. In Jesus' name. Make some noise for everybody that's watching on live stream. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise God. So before you're seated, we want to acknowledge some other very important people, those who are first-time attenders. If this is your first time with us, we're not going to embarrass you, not going to ask you to say anything. We want you to do two things. Number one, can you just raise your hand in the air? This is your first time. And then just wave it like you just don't care. There goes some right over there. There goes some in the back. Come on, family church, look around.
Yeah.
Right there, right there. Praise God, right there. Amen. God bless you. Right there, over there. Come on now, for the next 62 seconds, can we just walk around and greet everybody, everybody around you, and welcome them to the family church. Can somebody sing my song?
Say welcome to the family church, the family church, that you belong. Welcome to the family church, the family church. Church.
Mesa, Wagwan, Aloha, Oribo, Sakpase. How we doing today? Are we blessed?
Amen.
All the nations. Amen. Praise God. Welcome. My name is Pastor Ted Winsley. I am the pastor of the Family Church, and next to me is my co-pastor, your pastor, my wifey for lifey, 26 years in the game. Praise God, Pastor Dawn Winsley. Pastor Dawn, I saw that there were first timers all over the place.
Yeah, everybody, it's a lot of people all over.
Amen. Amen. Can you talk to them? Welcome.
We're the first timers. Wave at me one more time. Oh.
Amen. Amen. Praise God. Praise Service God. Coordinators, it's hot in here.
No,
Service
it's not. It's
hot
in here.
Turn some air on.
It's cold.
It's hot. No, it's not. Are y'all warm? Is this warm? Yeah, turn on the air. Turn on the air.
The air is on, man.
Well, keep it on.
It's on.
Amen.
Glory to God. Oh, my God. Amen. Listen, to our first timers.
I feel like I'm having hot flashes.
I know. You just this, yeah.
Amen.
To our first timers.
Every time I try to be cute, it's hot. Amen.
You want to let me say something to the first timers?
Say something to the first timers.
Glory to God. To our first timers, we welcome your presence this morning. They're all over the building. We thank you for coming out and worshiping with us. Look, now everybody trying to fan.
See, it's hot. It's hot.
Everybody doing this
he
Facebook
Live. He got on a
t-shirt
live. And it's hot.
Everybody
it's
hot. Doing this.
Got on short sleeves
trying
and it's
to
hot.
Send me a message. That's Amen. All
don't
right.
Let them know, y'all. Let them know.
Don't worry. When they hear the message, then they'll understand why it's off.
Okay.
Glory to God.
Silly.
So then you got to incorporate
turn it back
that.
On.
Yeah. Amen.
Amen.
Anyway.
Believe God. Trust God.
I trust him.
Amen.
Amen. Anyway, to our first timers, we thank you for visiting with us. Listen, there are some connect cards possibly in your presence. If not, raise your hand and we'll have one of the ushers pass one of those out to you. Take it down to our cafe after filling it out and we'll bless you real good down there. We'll give you something to eat and something to drink
on
the Lord. Amen. Come on, let's give our first timers another warm round of applause.
Amen. Praise God. And for those of you that are not first timers, you know the drill. It's time to get out your cell phones. Get out your cell phones
yes.
at this time. Stop hiding the fact that you have a cell phone out in church. It's all good. Amen. I want you to now connect with us on social media. We're right now, we're live streaming on YouTube,
yes.
on Facebook. If you're on Facebook, go ahead to the Family Church NJ. Start a watch party. Come on, push the button. Push the button. Push the button. That's from what movie is that from? That was from Rush Hour. Amen.
Push My the God.
Button. All right. So go ahead and push the button. Push the button. Start a watch party. Go ahead and like our page. If you're on YouTube, also subscribe to our YouTube page. And we're really, really excited that when you do that, it actually gets the word out in places where the word would not normally be.
Amen.
So give yourselves a hand for connecting with social media right now. Amen. Praise God. That was very weak.
No, because they
Amen.
On social media. They type
Okay, I'm sorry. Y'all doing like this. I'm sorry. Praise God. Pastor Dawn, we have some video announcements. Well, not video
yes.
announcements. We have some announcements. Can y'all click it there to the first announcement? Our first announcement is, how many of you have been taking part in our 21 days of prayer and fasting? Praise God. And we're going to learn more about that. We're going to be preaching along those lines today, realizing how important prayer and fasting is and understand that this isn't just something that we do because it's the first of the year. We're doing it because we're believing that God's going to break ground and we're going to break ground.
Yes.
And we're going to find out that prayer and fasting is a discipline that makes disciples. Mm-hmm. Who's being discipled? Amen. Praise God. And so during our 21 days of prayer and fasting, it's been amazing. If you're not familiar, if you don't know, our cadence is on Mondays. The prayer directive comes out for the week. We actually have a prayer directive every day. We have a prayer directive today. The prayer directive for today is what kind of vessel are you? Someone
yeah.
say, what kind of vessel am
what
I?
What kind of vessel?
Amen. And so every, amen. I don't know. One of honor. Amen. And so every day we have a prayer directive that comes out. At 5:30, someone say 5:30 in the morning.
5:30 in the morning.
5:30 in the morning because you are fasting and we're putting God first. You guys are getting on the prayer line. We had over almost 200 people
yeah.
on the prayer line. 5:30
in the morning.
Come on, y'all.
It's
Give
a
yourselves
lot of fun.
A hand. And the rest of y'all clap to act like you were one of the 200. Go ahead.
Yes.
It's all good.
It could be believable.
Amen. So there's still time to get involved. So 5:30 in the morning, we have our prayer call. Then at 12:30, somebody say 12:30
p.m.
12:30 p.m. We're on social media. We're on Facebook Live and we're on YouTube. And we're doing a live stream, our midday devotional. It's been really, really good. Thousands of people are getting on and are viewing our midday devotionals. And so we go a little deeper. We share practical tips, things that we don't talk about in the prayer in the morning. We kind of share a practical application. And then at 9:30, somebody say 9:30
p.m.?
9:30 p.m. We ask you to stop, drop, and pray. No matter where you are in the world. Just ask you for 10 minutes to take that prayer directive that you were involved in at 5:30. And at 12:30, now at 9:30, pray with your wife. Pray with your children. Pray with your
And when you're driving, don't close your eyes and then go through a light and then the cops stop you.
Don't
you say, my pastor said I got
don't
the...
No. Don't bring me up.
Use wisdom.
Praise
Keep
God.
Your eyes open and pray.
Please.
10 minutes.
Amen. And on Monday for our midday devotion, we're going to have a special one. So make sure you tune in. We actually are going to have a live audience. So it's going to be really, really dope. So make sure you're involved. And then also, somebody say January 23rd. Which is still part of our 21 days of prayer. We're going to have a lunchtime corporate prayer. Amen. So for 1 hour, if you can get away from your job, don't get fired. Amen. If you can get away from your job or whatever you're doing on the 23rd from 1 to 2 p.m., we're going to be right here praying the ground to shake and break. Amen. And we're going to be praying for our country, our world, our city, our families, for marriages, for
different
our children.
Islands, all that.
Amen. Just everything. We're going to be doing what God's called us to do when we come together. So we're looking forward for anybody who's available. Push out and do that. And then January the 17th. Somebody say January 17th?
January 17th,
7:30 p.m. I believe that's on a Friday night. We're going to have our Shabbat service. Somebody say Shabbat service.
Shabbat.
Amen. Like, what is that? So our Shabbat service is not here. We're going to actually we do this every year. Since our conception, we actually started in a Jewish synagogue. I don't know if any of you know that, but we partnered with Temple Emmanuel, and they allowed us to use their temple to praise Jesus. Come on, somebody. And we prayed. We were Jesus, 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 all in Temple Emmanuel. And because of that, we forged a relationship, a partnership with them. There are times where they'll call me out and ask me to actually teach classes to some of their Jewish population. I minister to their high school kids. God's amazing. And so what we're basically they invited us to take over their service. I'm going to be the guest speaker. Come on, somebody. Our worship team is actually going to be there. We're going to be we'll probably be singing Yahweh, Yahweh. Amen. And then I believe JP's been working it out, but I think they're coming here during this week to rehearse so that they're going to then do a joint choir or a joint ministry. So it's going to be really, really powerful. So please come on out and worship with us and let's praise our God.
Can
Amen.
I say one thing?
Please say two things.
Historically, when we would go there, their choir would sing and then our choir would sing.
Yes.
Now, you know our choir, right? You
come
know
on,
our
somebody.
Folk.
Come on.
So they said, man, when y'all sing, I just feel something. I don't know what it is. We said, we know what it is.
It's called the Holy Spirit.
So it's a blessing that they want to join us.
Amen.
To sing.
Praise God.
Because you know we still singing.
Amen. Yeah, we don't
Amen.
Hold back. And it's amazing. And we'll look and see if it happens again. But without fail, every time we go on that Friday, normally on the next Sunday or the Sunday after that, there's little yarmulkes in the sanctuary. In other words, some of their congregation members just say, we want to come to your service and just see how you do what you do, because it blessed us when you came here, and we want to be a part of that. So we're excited just how God is moving. And really, to be honest with you, it is a big outreach opportunity. Amen. Praise God. All right. So next we've got, somebody shout, going public.
Going public.
Amen. We're having a water baptism service on January the 26th. Come on now. All types of amazing stuff's happening here. So if you've never been water baptized, water baptism, it doesn't get you saved, but it's the first act of obedience. It's an outward show that there's been an inward transformation. You are identifying with the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. How many of you have some things in your life that need to die, be buried, and something new rise? Amen.
And so people who actually have been water baptized before actually go through our water baptism class, and they get water baptized again. I don't know about you, the first two times I was too young to understand what was going on. Is this anybody? Just me? It's just me. Okay. And so we give you an opportunity, if you really didn't understand what it meant, well, you can learn, and then be water baptized. We call it going public. And we've also had marriages. How many of you know some of our marriages need to drown? Y'all didn't like that. And then rise again. Amen. And so there are some couples who said, you know what, we've gone through stuff in our marriage, and we've made a rededication to God in our marriage, and we want to go public together. You can do that. Right. You can fill out the form, and we will take you down, and I promise you, you'll come back up. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. All right. Next is at the end of our 21 days of prayer and fasting, we're going to have a worship night. Come on. See, this thing is intense. All this is going on during these 21 days. And so we're going to have a special guest is going to come out and join Culture Shock. And how many of you have ever been in worship during a service and we had to stop and move on? He said, man, I wish we could just keep going. Well, guess what? During worship night, we're just going to keep going. And we're just going to get in his presence, and we're going to celebrate the things that are broken and things that have been reborn during our 21 days of prayer and fasting. What a way to start off the year. Amen.
Amen.
Somebody shout fight night.
Night.
All right. Point man, where you at? For those of you that don't know what that is, if you're a man, when I say point man, where you at, you just shout, we're on point. Point man, where you at?
Point
man, where you at? Praise God. Well, guess what? Our first event for the year for the point man is we're going on a road trip. Come on, y'all. So we're going to Fusion Church in Egg Harbor Township. And it's something called Fight Night. Their men at the Fusion Church, Pastor Brendan Wilson, if y'all remember, he preached here for our anniversary. That's my brother from another mother. He's from West Africa. Amen. He's African. Praise God. And so we're going to be joining forces, and I'm going to go down there, and I'm going to be the keynote speaker during Fight Night. I'm actually going to minister something I've ministered to you before, but I'm going to do it in a little different way. And it's called Bully, if y'all remember that. And so we're going to learn, in order to beat a bully, you have to become a bully. And so we're going to go down there. We're going to teach the men how to punch something in the face, not the wives. Amen. But we're going to punch the enemy in the face. And so we're going to ask for all the men, President. We're going to ask for all the men to come out on this road trip. And then invite other men. Say, hey, man, let's go to fight night. It's going to be an amazing time. And so we're excited about that. And then one more announcement. Is there one more? Somebody shout. Somebody shout hard ground.
Hard ground.
So in order to break ground, we talked about this before, there are two types of ground. There's the ground that's known and the ground that's unknown. And how many of you know, before you can have good ground, you got to break the hard ground. And so, amen, that's clappable. And so this Wednesday, we're going to have our first midweek service for 2020. And we're going to begin for all the rest of the year, and our first series is called Hard Ground. So I want to invite some of you. We normally have maybe about 150, sometimes 200 people come out. And I'm believing God that one day just all y'all going to come out. Amen. Because how many of you know that you don't get it all on Sunday? You really don't. And so on Wednesdays, we have an opportunity to go deeper, to go longer, not necessarily in time, but sometimes we'll have a series that'll go for 7 weeks. Come on, something. And just dealing with a subject and really getting in our spirit. So I want to encourage you to come out this Wednesday as we start the series called Hard Ground. And if you just physically can't be there, get online and you can watch it. Who's excited about that? Amen. Praise God. Amen.
Amen. Now we're going to transition to honoring the people who took the next step classes.
Amen. Amen. What's the next step class?
So the next step classes, these are individuals that said, we are ready to put our hands to the plow.
Amen.
Move over, because we got some gifts on the inside of us.
Praise God.
And we want those gifts to be utilized here at the family church. So in other words, they're going to start serving. Amen.
Amen. Praise God.
Amen. So for those of you who will be getting your new member certificates this morning, I need you to make your way up to the stage. You can either go up through this side or this side, and come on up. Hurry up. Amen. Because if I had something to give you, you'd be running up here. Come on.
Yeah, right.
Amen. Price is right. Let's go. Jesus paid it all. Let's go. And so we just want to honor them, and we're excited about what God is doing, because how many of you know he's sending more people so that we can reach more people?
Praise God. Somebody should get excited about that God's sending more so we can do more. Amen.
We're excited. Yeah. Amen. Here they go.
Y'all can just stand in a line, right
stand
on the
right
there
here
you go.
In the line.
There you go. Right. You good? Amen. Y'all Amen. So obedient.
Yep.
You do everything
One,
I
two,
say for now. Three. Praise God.
Glory Praise to God. And listen, we're gonna call your names, and certificates can be obtained from the Welcome Center. Okay. All right, so there's quite a few people on the list. Some people weren't able to be here this morning, but we're still going to call their names and honor them. When we call your name, can you just step up front, give everybody a love wave?
Amen.
Amen. And then you can
Ladies, y'all
can
do it like this.
Back.
Just do it like that.
Amen. Amen. All right.
Gentlemen, don't do it like that.
If I don't call your name, it's because I got this another person they just asked. They're not here today. All right, Holly Coleman. Amen.
Clap for Holly.
Clap
Amen.
For Holly. Nyla Coleman. Come on, Amen. Nyla. Take a step and give a wave. Amen. Enid. Is Enid here? Come on, somebody. Enid. Amen. Take a step.
Amen. Praise God.
Amen. That's a good... I love that last name. I just don't want to mess it up. Sapphire Henry. Are you here? Valencia Jordan.
Hey, Valencia.
Amen. Philip Lopez.
Philip. Let's go, baby boy.
Amen. Carol McDonald.
Amen.
Amen. Latasha Morris.
Latasha.
Frederick Poley.
Come on, Frederick.
Frederick.
Let's
Amen.
Go. Amen.
Danielle Porter.
Danielle.
Woo.
Amen.
Keyshawn
like,
Taylor.
That was some swagger, Danielle.
Hey.
Come on now.
And the Wedderburns, they weren't able to be here, but it's three of them, Dwayne, Jaden, and Ciamara.
Let's go.
Amen.
Praise God.
Come on, let's stand to our feet and give our newest serving folk a big hand clap.
Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. Now, we're just going to pray for them. If you could just stretch your hands in the direction that they're in. The Bible says that when we lay hands on people, that we actually stir up the gift that's on the
Yes.
inside of them. So, Father, we give you glory, honor, and praise. We thank you. In obedience to your word, we lay hands upon your sons and your daughters. And we thank you, Father God, right now that you would stir up the gift, Lord, that you created on the inside of. You said before they were formed in their mother's belly, God, you knew them. You approved of them. You had a purpose, a destiny, and a destination. And we anoint and stir up the gift right now in the mighty name of Jesus. We thank you, Father God, that creativity and power and authority, God, is now resting upon their lives to serve and to bless other people, not just in the church, but as the church. And we thank you, Father God, that your word says that in your kingdom, there isn't just giving, but there's also giving and receiving. And so we thank you, Father God, as they are sowing their lives, they will reap a harvest, Father God, of protection, Father God, of grace, of mercy, of power, of kingdom authority, because they are your sons and your daughters. And your word says when they put their hand to the plow, they will not look back. And so we glory, we give you glory, honor, and praise in Jesus' mighty name. And the entire congregation shouted, Amen.
Yeah.
Praise God. Come on, let's give them a hand once again. Amen. As they walk off, praise God. Awesome.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Praise God.
Praise God. Well,
that was awesome.
Well, before we prepare our hearts for the word in worship, I don't know if any of you have ever seen or we started this on New Year's. We've been showing testimonies of people whose lives have been changed. How many of you saw that on social media?
40,000 people
Jess,
saw
you
it.
Broke the internet. Amen. So we've been showing the testimonies of how God has changed people's lives during 2019, which was the year of the promise reign, and now going into 2020. So every Sunday, we're just going to show a different testimonial. So we want you to check this out. And then immediately following that, the worship team is going to come up, and we can come to the altar and prepare our hearts Amen. For the word. Amen.
My name is Tetra Shockley. I've been a member of the Family Church since the launch in September of 2016, and I am currently an associate attorney at Benton Lynn Law in Dover, Delaware. In order to appreciate what the year of the promised reign has meant for me, we have to go back to the beginning. We have to go back to the foundation of September 11, 2016 with restoration, with God restoring or bringing back his original intent for our lives. That's really where the launch was for me and changing my life and understanding that it wasn't about what I wanted in life or things that I felt I missed out on or lost, but it was about, God, what do you want for me? And how do I position myself to get that? In October of 2017, I started a new job. And my employer offered me either straight salary or commission. And I said, well, my bills are guaranteed, so I need my salary to be guaranteed. So I decided to take the salary. Well, lo and behold, on the very last Sunday of December 2017, Pastor Ted taught the first message on momentum for greater expectations. And in that service, I don't even remember what Pastor Ted said that sparked it, but I know the Holy Spirit said to me, you're limiting me. You have handcuffs on me. And I'm like, I don't know what you're talking about. What do you mean? And he said, if your income is salary based, then that's all you'll make. But if you'll trust me, I'll blow your mind with a commission. And of course I cried. I said, that's scary. Trusting God with my income for my family and private school tuition and bills. But I said, I hear you, God, and I'll do it. So the very next day, that Monday, I went to work and I sat down with my boss and I said, I know I didn't take originally the commission, but now I want to. And in the month of January alone, God more than doubled my income. And by the time the year 2017 was over, my overall income was more than two times what it would have been if I would have stuck with the salary. Well, 2019, we kick off the year with the year of the promised reign, becoming king publicly. And I knew immediately that this was a setup, that this was a God-ordained, a divine appointed time for my life. And I didn't fully understand what it meant, but I knew that he was going to use this platform to launch other things in my life. I just believed that the word was true. God confirmed for me that I was going to be Mrs. Cosmos United States. I knew it in the very fiber of my being. And so lo and behold, in January of 2019, this year, the year of the promised ring, I went to the Mrs. Cosmos United States pageant and had a great time all week. All week, I was getting favor from people, and I equated it right back to the story of Esther. Esther had favor. She had favor from the king and from the people, and I knew God was setting me up. And so the night of the finals, I'm standing there. It's me and one other lady, and they're about to call the first runner-up, and I knew that it was going to be her. And so when they said first runner up, Mrs. Delaware, Tetra Shockley, I was disappointed. Thankfully, I have a pastor who hears from God. That very next day, Pastor Ted called me and said, so let's talk, because he knows me and he cares. And so we talked about what God told me. And I said, you know, maybe I just missed it. Maybe I'm crazy and I'm losing my mind. And he said, no, you know what God said. He said, so get it together and let's go back next year and let's win it again. And so I prayed about it. I said, okay, God, I understand that sometimes not now doesn't mean not ever. That's something else my pastor taught me. And so I prayed about it, and God said, no, you're going to be Mrs. Cosmos. You are, excuse me. He said, you are Mrs. Cosmos United States 2019. And I'm like, no, I'm not. I'm not. That it's someone else. So anyway, fast forward, I went to the international pageant. Even though I didn't win the United States pageant, they still offered me an opportunity to go to Jamaica and compete in the international pageant. And while I was there, the young lady who had won the Cosmos United States pageant won the Mrs. Cosmos International pageant. And because she won that, as the first runner-up to her at the Cosmos United States pageant, I became Mrs. Cosmos United States. And then I understood. So just like our pastor teaches us, it's not what you saw. What do you see? And standing on the word of God, even when it doesn't look the way you thought it would look or turn out the way you thought it would turn out. So as I waited to receive my crown and sash, my Mrs. Cosmos United States crown and sash, the Holy Spirit said, don't let anyone else put that crown on your head. Don't let anyone else clothe you with that sash. I want to do it. And he told me that he would do it through our pastors. So I called Pastor Ted and I told him what the Holy Ghost said, and he said, done. As soon as you get the crown and sash, let me know. And so we did. As soon as I got it, I called him, and he and Pastor Dawn took me in his office. No fanfare, because that's not what it was about. It was just about God doing what he said he would do for me.
Hallelujah. Come on, let's just stand on our feet one more time. And I invite you to the river just before we hear what God wants to say to us today. Thank you, Lord. Simple song.
It says, I will sing unto you my King unto the Lamb. I lift my hands, for you are holy. And I will sing, sing unto you, my King unto the Lamb. I lift my hands, for you are holy.
Come on, let's sing that together. One voice, say,
I will sing
unto you.
Sing unto you. Unto the Lamb.
Unto the Lamb.
I lift my hands.
I lift my hands.
For you are.
For you are holy.
It's real simple. Let's sing it again. I will.
I will sing unto you.
Unto the Lamb,
to the Lamb,
I lift my hands.
Lift
Let's call him mighty. Say,
for you are mighty.
Say, for you are holy, Lord.
Holy,
hey, unto the Lamb. Yeah, say. Can y'all sing a real strong? Say,
for you are
unto the Lamb, I lift my hands, for you are. Let's sing it from the top real strong. Say, I will, say,
I will sing.
Sing unto you.
Sing unto you.
Hey.
Unto the Lamb,
I lift my hands,
for you are.
Do I have any worshipers in the room that know your Father? Say,
I will sing unto you,
unto the Lamb. I lift my hands.
Oh,
hey, say, for you are whole. You know it. Let's sing it together.
For you are holy.
You are holy, yeah.
Holy.
Unto the Lamb, I lift my hands.
For you are
holy. Now let's call him righteous. Say,
for you.
Say, hey,
unto the Lamb,
I lift my hands,
for you are,
yeah, can you call him holy,
for you are,
and we honor your name, holy, yeah,
unto the Lamb,
I lift my hands,
for you are.
Now one more time real strong, let's call him Father.
You are my
Father, and we love you today.
Father,
hey. Unto the Lamb,
we lift our hands,
for you are my Father. You're my Father. And worship. We lift our hands unto the Lamb. We lift our hands. We lift our hands. We'll give you all the glory. We lift our hands. We'll give you all the praise. We lift our hands forever and ever.
to the Lamb. We lift our hands,
for you're holy.
For you are holy.
Hallelujah. Father, we worship you. We thank you that we serve a holy, righteous God. We thank you this morning as we come to the second Sunday of 2020. We call you not just God, but we call you Daddy. We call you Father. And because we call you Daddy, and because we call you Father, you call us son, you call us daughter, and a father knows our name. Right now, in the mighty name of Jesus, we thank you, Holy Spirit, that you are imparting and re-imparting our identity. Right now, in the very presence of God, allow us to remember that our Daddy knows our name. Our Daddy is our identity. I'm not where I came from. I'm not what happened to me. I am my Father's child. He knows my name. He thinks I'm lovely. He calls me beautiful. He gives me favor. He's graced me with mercy. I am his favorite child. And if all those things are true, I have nothing to fear. I have nothing to fear. I have nothing to worry. He said, my rod and my staff, they're gonna comfort you. My authority and my power is with you. You have authority, son. You have authority, daughter. You have power, my son. You have power, my daughter. And I promise you, I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. I sent my son that gave his life to ensure we'd always be together. Father, we thank you today as we come corporately to worship you, corporately to receive from you. Now do the miraculous. Allow us to receive individually. Allow us to hear individually. We're standing in the crowd, but all you see is me. Oh, come on, make that personal. You're standing in the crowd, but all he sees is you. We thank you as your word comes forward. You'll just talk to one person as you speak to everyone. And we declare 2020 breaking ground. We declare 2020 breaking ground. We declare what's been holding us back all our lives will break. We declare that the new and unseen things, we will break new ground, and you will get all the glory. We thank you and we praise you. In Jesus' mighty name. If you're in agreement with that prayer, come on, real fast, just give God some praise. Give him some praise. Give him some praise. Give him some praise. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Woo! Praise God. Who's ready for the word today? Anybody ready for the word? They seem a little more excited. Who's ready for the word? Y'all excited over here? Who's ready? There you go. Come on, side view. Come on, side view. Praise God. Well, we're just going to jump right in. This is week two of our series, which is the theme for the year called Breaking Ground. And come on, let's just jump right into Micah chapter 2, verse 13. You ready? Come on, let's read. It says what? The who? Come on, ready? Let's read. It says who? The what? Come on, it says who? The what? Come on, how many of you know that the breaker is the Messiah? Come on, talk. How many of you know that the Messiah is Jesus? How many of you know that the Bible says what we're learning, what we're realizing, that if we allow Jesus to be the breaker, we're going to break through. If we're going to allow Jesus, the Messiah, to be the breaker, we're going to break ground. And so it says here, what? The breaker, the Messiah, what's he going to do? Will go up before them. Now, I said this in the first service, and I'll say this in the second service, and I'll probably say it in every service. When you read scripture, don't read it religiously. Read it prophetically. Y'all hear me? I'll say it again. When you read scripture, don't read it religiously. Read it prophetically. We're going to have class today. I'm going to do some teaching. Can y'all handle it? I'm going to give you some practical stuff. How many of you know, what does the word prophetically mean? Anybody know? What does it mean, prophetic? It's done. How many of you know that when you hear something prophetic, it is sharing with you your future right now? Who's ready for that? And so when we read this scripture, don't read it religiously. Religiously is, I've read this before, and you still don't know what it means. Prophetically is when I read this, he's talking to me. Prophetically is when I read this, this has to do with what I'm going through, with what I'm afraid of, with what I'm worried about, with what I'm hopeful for. This has to do with me. Somebody say, this has to do with me. All right, now having said that, let's read it prophetically. It says what? The breaker who? The Messiah will go up before them. Come on. It says what? They will break through. Stop. What if you read that prophetically? Then the they wouldn't be they, the they would be me. Come on, let's read that again. You ready? You ready to turn the they into me? Who needs they to be me? Anybody? Maybe you don't. Maybe you got it all together. Maybe you've already broke through. Maybe you don't need they to be me. Anybody need they to be me? Come on, well, let's turn they into me. Y'all ready? Let's read. It says what? The breaker, the Messiah, will go up before me. It says, watch this, and then I will break through. Oh, come on. Can I come over here, side view? See, watch this. God needs you to get this year, because this is the year that you break through. This is the year that you break ground. This is the year that you become groundbreaking. Are you hearing me? And then watch this. Come on, let's read this prophetically. And then it says what? And then what? I will break through, watch this, and then I will pass in through the gate and go out through it. Come on, stop right there. See, the only reason why some of you are not excited yet, because you don't know that the gate represents power and authority. See, this is the year that when you break ground, when you break through, then you're going to pass through gates. See, without this mindset, when you see a gate, you see something that's holding you back instead of something that I'm about to go through. Come on, talk to me. And so watch this. It says the breaker, the Messiah, watch this. He's going to go before me. Read me. It says what? And I will break through, and I will pass through the gate, and I'll go out through it. Watch this. And it says, and my king will pass on before me, and the Lord is my head. Oh, come on, guys. Some of you are worried because you think your head is your boss. Come on. Some of y'all ladies, you're worried because you think your head is your husband. Oh, Lord, it ain't never going to happen if I got to focus on him. Well, guess what? You're right. But if you would focus on the Messiah, then the Messiah will show you and cause you to look at him in a way that you never looked at him. And watch this. That's why the Bible says that Sarah, when he was a sucker, called Abraham Lord. Come on, talk to me. And how many of you know that if you call him a sucker, he'll act like one? But if you call him a man of God, you'll see him that way. That was just free. Ain't even in the notes. Can y'all handle that? Anybody mad? I don't care. Watch this. Here we go. It says what? Let's read our introduction. It says what? It says God spoke a prophetic word in the Old Testament that Christ the Messiah has fulfilled today. And today is a very simple message. We're in our 21 days of prayer and fasting. I promise you, we're going to go deeper next week. Next week is deeper. But how many of you know that simple is deep too? And watch this. And simple is deep because most of the time, simple is so simple, you miss it. Simple is so simple, you don't use it. If you look at our notes, the title is what? Is the year of breaking ground. But the subtitle is what? What's the subtitle? What's the subtitle? It's time to use your tools. And any builders in the house, anybody know anything about building? Raise your hands if you know something about building. Come on, keep your hands up. Raise your hand if you know something about building. It ain't just got to be the men. Anybody know anything about? Nobody, you don't know nothing about building. Praise God. Thank you. Hey, you be breaking bones. You know a lot about building. Hey, watch this. So here's my foot doctor. What do you call it, a podiatrist? Amen. Come on, I got that. So you're a foot doctor. And what happens if a foot doctor were to show up on the job with no tools? Amen. Be a long day. Or watch this, or it would be a problem. How many of you know if you showed up on a building site and you didn't have your tools, the foreman would do two things. One, they would send you home. You want to know why? Well, here's a reason why. They'll send you home because if you show up on the site without your tools, you know, one thing, you'll be unproductive. Come on. And number two, you'll get in the way. the number through, you'll get three, you'll get hurt. How many of you know if you're on a site that you're supposed to be, but you don't have the right tools, you'll be unproductive, you'll get in the way, and you'll get hurt. And so how many of you know that your life is the job site? And we're going to find out in 2020, if I'm going to break ground, I got to learn how to use my tools. Come on, talk to me. Come on, let me get that. My son's saying, Dad, you're irritating me because you're sweating all over the place. Praise God. Catch that. It's anointing. So watch it. It says what? God spoke a word. It said the Messiah has fulfilled today. So what? He has come as the breaker to deliver and empower us to do what? To break ground where? In the areas of our lives that have what? That have prevented us from building the kingdom of heaven in the earth for God's glory. Come on, here we go. It says what? Breaking ground means, watch this, by the power of God to become and to produce something like nothing. Y'all remember that last week? See, the definition of breaking ground is when you become and when you produce something like nothing. Somebody say, I'm something like nothing. Come on, tell your neighbor, say, I'm something like nothing. Something like nothing what? Something like nothing that's ever been done. Something like nothing that's ever been experienced. Something like nothing that's ever been created before. How many of you know when you become something like nothing, you become groundbreaking? Are y'all hearing me? When you become something like nothing, you'll realize that it don't take money, that people will give you favor. Come on, I'm trying to share with you. Some of you are like, man, I need to get another job. I need three jobs. I need four jobs. No, you need to become something like nothing. You need to allow God to show you how to break the known ground so you can become groundbreaking. And literally, how many of you know what will happen is when you break ground, people will really see you now. How many of you know that you're just hiding behind dirt until you break ground? Are y'all hearing me? Come on, let's read. Watch this. It says what? Today what? Today we're going to begin to discover and understand what? The spiritual tools that lead to breaking ground and breaking through. And like I said, come on, put on your student hats. I'm going to give you a lot of scripture. I'm going to give you a lot of notes. But you're going to have a lot of power when you're done. Okay, so today's going to be practical because we're going to learn that there are five tools. Somebody say five tools. There are five tools that should not only always be in your bag, but should always be in your life. Because I don't even know, you can have all the tools you need in your bag, but guess what? If you don't know when to take them out and if you don't use them, you'll actually look like a barren land instead of a construction site. And so we're going to get this revelation today. It says what? That there are five tools that lead to breaking ground and breaking through. And the Lord told me during this week, he said, look, I want you to be practical on this Sunday because I don't want their fast to be religious. I want it to be transformative. See, guess what? There's no reason to do something if it's not going to change you. Are you hearing me? If it's not going to change, watch this. If you're doing something right now that's not changing, you stop doing it the way you're doing it. Amen? Come on, some of y'all thought, I said you can get out that marriage. No, stop doing it the way you're doing it. Let's read. Come on. So watch this. Somebody say there's five tools. Somebody say, Pastor Ted, teach me the tools. Come on, here we go. Real simple. Number one is prayer with fasting. Uh-oh. So watch this. The first tool that we need to have in our bag and understand is, what does it say? Is prayer, watch this, with fasting. How many of you know that the scripture says that there was a man, we shared this scripture, I think, on New Year's Eve, but there was a man whose son was epileptic, and he had taken him to the disciples, and the disciples couldn't do anything, and then he came back, and finally he spoke to the man, and he said, Jesus, if you could do anything, help us. And then Jesus said, if I could do anything, man, this has to do with you and your faith. And he said, Lord, help my unbelief. And then he had a conversation with the disciples, and they said, Lord, why couldn't we do this? And Jesus said, because you haven't been using your tools. He said, because there are something, because watch this, because then Jesus did what they couldn't do, but what they could have done. And Jesus said that these things only happen or only come out through prayer with fasting. How are we doing? We okay? How many of you are excited that you are on a 21-day prayer with fasting? Amen. Just raise your hand if you're not doing it. Just raise your hand by faith. Praise God. And maybe Monday you'll start. Praise God. Let's read Daniel chapter 10, verse 1 through 3, and then 11 through 14. Come on, we're going to teach. Somebody say, teach me. Come on, let's read. It says what? In the third year of the reign of King Cyrus of Persia, Daniel, also known as Belshazzar. And it's funny, and when you study, when you read, you'll find out that Daniel was his slave name. Belshazzar was actually his Hebrew name. It was the name that connected to his God. And how many of you know that it's okay that what people call you, as a matter of fact, in other words, you won't even care what people call you when you know what God's called you. And it says what? And Belshazzar had and that's why the only reason I said that side view is because the reason why it was written that way is because when the world called him Daniel, God called him by his name. And let's read, and it says what? He had another vision. And let's read, what did he do? He understood that the vision concerned, and I love this, events certain to happen in the future. And how many of you know that when we begin to use our tools and begin to operate in spiritual disciplines, God will set you up to know what's coming. How are we doing? See, he didn't promise you that bad wasn't going to happen, but he did promise you that it shouldn't catch you off guard. Come on, we hear this all the time, and I make fun of it, how Christians say, you know what, this is my slave voice. Well, you know, the Lord sure do work in mysterious ways. How many of you know that if that is the case, it's because we're not connected? Because God doesn't want anything to be a mystery to you. How many of you know that? The Bible says that he even sent the Holy Spirit so he would actually take what belongs to God and show you what's coming. Is this making sense? So watch this. So it says he understood that the vision concerned events certain to happen in the future, times of war and great hardship. Verse 2, it says what? When this vision came to me, he said, I, Daniel, what had Daniel been in? He said he had been in mourning for 3 whole years. Is that what it says? For what? For 3 whole years. Is that what it said? Come on. I mean, you know, if you're not fasting and praying in the spirit, 21 days feels like 21 years. Come on, y'all. That's why some of the stuff that you left in the freezer and then you started to fast on Monday has been calling you from the freezer. So it says Daniel had been in mourning. In other words, it was saying that Daniel had put his flesh to death for 21 days. How are we doing? Let's read. Verse 3, it says what? And all that time I had eaten, watch this, is Daniel talking. He said, all that time, read with me, I had eaten no rich food. He said what? No meat or wine crossed my lips, and I used no fragrant lotions. Now, you don't have to do that. Don't be ashy. But in other words, what the scripture was saying is that Daniel says, you know what? Everything that speaks to my flesh, I'm going to shut it up during these 21 days. It says, watch this. And it says, I use no fragrant lotions until those 3 weeks had passed. Come on, verse 11. It says what? And then watch this. And here we're going to find out what expectations that you should have during your 21 days. It says, and the man said to me, what? Daniel. So all of a sudden, he's fasting, he's praying, and all of a sudden, the man shows up. Let's read. It says, watch this. And the man said to me, what? Daniel, you are very precious to God. He says, what? So listen carefully to what I have to say to you. And how many of you know it just wasn't a man, it was an angel. That after 21 days of prayer and fasting, crucifying his flesh, he had a visitation. Let's read. It says what? It says what? Stand up, for I have been sent to you. When he said this to me, I stood up, but I was still in a position of humility. See, we're going to find out, and hopefully you're getting this already, that praying with fasting should cause you to become more humble. Because it's not about you. You're not focusing on yourself. And so how many of you know that even after the 21 days of prayer and fasting is over, you should still have some humility? How are we doing? Come on, let's read. Verse 12, it says what? Then he said, watch this. I love this. Come on, let's read it prophetically. Then he said what? Don't be what? Then he said what? Don't be what? And we're going to find out throughout the year that really, we're going to talk about the hard ground, but the major thing that causes ground to become hard is called fear. Come on. That was real quiet. The major thing that causes your heart to become hard is called fear. And you've heard me say this before, that the thing that the devil attacks the most is what he's afraid of. Y'all hear me? Y'all understand that? See, because the enemy knows he's not attacking you because you're weak. Write this down. He's attacking you because you won. You didn't hear me. He's not, anybody going through an attack, if y'all could be honest, like, yo, I'm getting attacked. You're not getting attacked because you're weak. You're getting attacked because you won. Jesus actually won your victory, and the enemy is attacking you because he's trying to distract you from the fact that you won. Because he knows if you swing, it's over. And so we're going to find out through, at least for the first 6 months, we're going to start dealing with all of the hard ground that happened in our hearts because we were afraid. Let's read. It says what? Don't be afraid. Daniel says what? And somebody read this prophetically. It says what? Since the first day that you began to pray for understanding. Now, this is also amazing because when we're going through our 21 days of prayer and fasting, some of us get ahead of ourselves and we're praying for stuff. Come on now. I messed up your whole fast. We're praying for stuff instead of praying for understanding. Because how many of you know, God can give you this stuff, but if you don't understand, it will be taken away. But the moment that you understand, what you understand can never be taken, even if it's taken. How are we doing? Let's read. It says what? Then Daniel said, don't be afraid. What? Since the first day you began to pray for understanding. Watch this. To humble yourself before your God. Come on. Somebody read this like God's talking to you. It says what? Your request has been heard in heaven. Oh, gosh. How would your life change if you believe that the first time I prayed, he heard me? Watch this. Then after we pray, we wouldn't beg, we'd rejoice. See, how many of y'all know that when your child asks you for something, hey, mom, can I have a cookie? And you say yes, right? And then they ask again, that's called begging. Especially when I already answered you. But just because I answered you doesn't mean you're going to get the cookie now. Come on, talk to me. Oh, God, are you hearing me? See, how many of you know that yes means, so when God speaks a yes, he speaks it into your spirit, and then it's coming into the natural. And so watch this. He says here, I've come in answer to your request. So watch this. So he says, the first time you prayed, I heard, and now I've come to let you know, here's the answer. Come on, let's read. Verse 13. It's going to be real practical today. Y'all with me? Y'all hanging with me? Come on, watch this. Verse 13, it says what? But for 21 days, the spirit prince of the kingdom of Persia blocked my way. How many of you know that the reason why the enemy is going to attack is because he knows that God has heard you and has already answered your cry, already answered your situation, has already given you the solution to the problem you don't even know you have? Is this making sense? And so watch this. It says what? Then Michael, one of the archangels, came. And I love this because God's actually giving you detail that there is spiritual warfare going on. And how many know that even though there is a devil, he does have demons, they do have power, they're not all powerful, and God is all powerful, and God has more power than they do. How are we doing? Watch this, and it says here, and it says one of the archangels came to help me, and it says what? And I left him there to go ahead and kick his tail. Amen. Watch this, and it says, and with the spirit of the prince of the kingdom of Persia, verse 14, come on, somebody read. It says what? It says, now I am here to explain what will happen to your people in the future, for this vision concerns a time that is yet to come. And so this 21 days of prayer and fasting should be a time of confirmation. Come on, talk to me. Should be a time of hope. Should be a time that your fears get destroyed. Are y'all ready for this? See, I wanted to give you some explanation because how many of you know if we don't have understanding, then we'll be religious. Some of y'all been acting like the fasting police. Some of y'all in fasting in the house and there's I looked at the box. It's some sugar. It's some sugar in this. You so busy looking at boxes and you ain't even pray today. So it's important that we get understanding so this can be spiritual. How we doing? So come on, we're talking about the first tool. Somebody say the first tool. Watch this. Here we go. First tool is fasting. Let's read. It says what? Fasting for extended days. And how many of you know that you also have a tool that you can fast? You can fast for one day, but we're on a 21-day fast. Amen. Just then you know. But if you have a situation, a circumstance, something that's going on, man, I need understanding. I need some wisdom in this thing right now. I just got a bad report. I'm gonna push my plate away. Okay? But watch this read. It says what? But fasting for an extended days, it says it does what? It creates spiritual discipline. Now this is important because when you get discipline, this is what you do without thinking. This is what you do without planning. See, how many of you know that fasting gives you spiritual muscle memory? Because some of you, how many of you know some of you that when you get attacked or when something's happening, you don't have time to think. You just need to do it. How are we doing? And this is what prayer and fasting, extended prayer, extended fasting, it does. It creates what? It creates spiritual discipline. Watch this. That positions us for a visitation from God. And I want you to know that the place that God lands is called your heart. And see, here's the issue. We could be in this corporate setting. The presence of God is here. But if you're not in the place that you're supposed to be, he'll visit everybody, and you'll miss him. Why? Because this is spiritual and it's personal. Y'all ready? Come on, let's read. It says what? So we're talking about when we're fasting. Extended fasting or fasting for extended days. What does it do? It creates spiritual discipline that positions us, read with me, for a visitation from God, and what else? And that brings breakthrough over Satan's seducing temptations. And how many of you know that when you're fasting, temptation gets a little higher? Come on, I'm looking at you. See, watch this, because fasting is warfare. Prayer and fasting is warfare. We talked about this in a series that we did called Bully. Whether you realize it or not, when you decide to do something spiritual, you've picked a fight. That's what you've done. 21 days, you picked a fight. And how many of you know, because you picked a fight, now it's going to get a little hotter. All of a sudden, you know, and for gentlemen, and y'all can handle this, you know you ain't as good looking. You know you're not as good looking as people are acting around you. Like, all of a sudden, you fine. You wasn't fine last week. Come on, look straight. You wasn't fine last week, but now I started this 21 days of prayer and fast, and man, I'm getting looks, and people are stopping me and winking. It might even be in your head. Ain't nobody even looking at you, but you think you fine. And so what happens is during our time of prayer and fasting that God actually gives us supernatural power to stamp on the devil's head. And even if it's in your own mind, you'll have the power to say, man, I am tripping. The devil is the liar. I do have a wife, but even greater than me having a wife, I've got a Father in heaven who's here with me. Is this making sense? Can the men handle that with your fine selves? Amen. She's trying to get at me. She's trying to get it. Ain't nobody trying to get at you. Come on, let's read. It says, watch this. And we gain what? Both authority and power over the enemy. This is prayer and fasting. Somebody say, use your tools. Say, if you're not on it, get on it. Amen. That's number one. Y'all get anything out of this? Real practical today, but I need to help you. All right, watch this. Number two, watch this. It's praying in the spirit. Praying in the spirit. And watch this. I'm just going to tell you today. I don't have time to convince you. All right. I've done that in other series. There's a series called Possessed, if you want to get it. I did it on a midweek service. I talked about praying in the spirit, tongues, the gift of tongues with interpretation. We're not talking about that. We're just talking about the ability that comes after you've been baptized in the Holy Spirit to be able to pray in the spirit, to be able to pray directly to God. Somebody say, I need to use my tool. The Bible says that Paul, he wasn't talking about the gift of tongues with an interpretation. He was just talking about praying in the spirit. He said, I pray more than all of you do. Let's read. Come on. 1 Corinthians 14, it says what? What? For what? For one who speaks in an unknown tongue speaks not to men, but to God. It says what? For no one understands or catches his meaning. It says what? Because in the Holy Spirit, he utters secret truths and hidden things not obvious to the understanding. Watch this. It says Paul wrote that when we pray in the Spirit, we are specifically addressing God, not man. And here's the amazing part, that when you pray in the Spirit, that the Holy Spirit will bypass your mind and you'll speak directly to God. The Bible says that when you pray in the Spirit, you do two things. It builds up your most holy faith. See, in other words, when the fact that you know that I'm connecting with God, it builds your faith. There's a woman in the Old Testament. The Bible says that she was barren. I believe it was it Samuel or Eli's mom? I think it was Samuel's mom. She was barren. And the scripture said that that she got to the place that she realized, and it was and really it was a revelation from God, that she stopped asking God to give her a baby for herself, and she just said, you know what, God, will you open my womb so I could just carry your baby? Why? Because, Lord, I just want to know what it feels like to have what belongs to you on the inside of me. And the scripture said that she got pregnant and she gave that child to God. Literally, she dropped him off at the temple. And how many of you know that just her knowing what it feels like to be connected to God, to carry his baby, opened her womb, and then she had her own children. Why am I making that correlation? Because when you open yourself up to be baptized in the Holy Spirit, then guess what? The connection is, and I'm not even talking about in the gifts of the Spirit where you speak out, where you speak in front of people a prophetic word and then you get a prophetic tongue. I'm talking about you and God. Lord, I just want to know that I'm connected directly to you. I'm speaking directly to you. I'm speaking your perfect will, and it builds up my faith. Is this making sense? Come on, Romans chapter 8, verse 26. And how many of you know, and we'll read verse, is that right? Romans chapter 8, no, I went backwards. Romans chapter 8, verse 26 through 27. And how many of you know when you want to get an understanding of a scripture, don't just read the one scripture, well, really read the whole chapter, but at least read the first two or three scriptures that come before it. Because if not, you'll take it out of context. Come on, let's read it. It says what? In the same way, it says what? The Spirit, what is it? What does the Holy Spirit do? It helps us when? How many of you, when are you weak? All the time. It says what? But this is why some of us, because there are probably three types of people in the room. There are people who've never been baptized in the Holy Spirit. There are people who have been baptized in the Holy Spirit, but you wouldn't know it because they don't practice. And then there are people that realize, I'm so weak that I need to constantly stay in connection with the Holy Spirit, and I pray often. That's why Paul said, I pray more than all of you. And let's read, it says what? In the same way what the Spirit helps us when? In our weaknesses, read me, it says what? We do not know what we ought to pray for, but who does this? Our pastor? Come on, our grandmama that's always praying for us. Is that what it says? No, it says, but the Spirit himself, what does he do? See, intercession means when you realize you can't do it yourself and you need someone to get in between us. You need somebody to get in between us and make the connection. See, how many of you know that you know God, but you don't know him as much as your spirit does? And when we pray in the Spirit, the Holy Spirit actually intercedes between you and God, and he makes sure the connection gets through. Is this making sense? It says, watch this. He intercedes for us, and how does he do it? With what? With wordless groans. So in other words, I begin to speak words that I don't even understand. How many of you know when you pray in the Spirit, it actually insults your intelligence? You want to know why? Because you need your intelligence insulted. Some of you are so smart that you're stupid as it relates to spiritual things. You know everything. You know somebody that know everything. You know everything in the natural, but don't know anything spiritually because you're so smart that you won't let your mind be insulted. And how many of you know that that's what the Holy Spirit does? He says, you know what? Turn your mind off, because your mind is only a byproduct of why you're here. God gave you a mind because you're a spiritual being in the earth. And watch this. And when we connect with the Holy Spirit, he insults our mind, goes past our mind, and our spirit to spirit connects. Let's read. It says what? But the Spirit himself intercedes with what? With wordless groans. Verse 27, it says what? And what? And he who searches what? Our hearts. He knows the mind of what? Of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for God's people in accordance with what? So when you pray in the Spirit, you actually pray the perfect will of God. And anybody ever gone to one of those churches where when they pray, you feel stupid? You know what I'm talking about? Dear Heavenly Most Gracious Father of the fourth quadrant of the realm of words that I don't even know how to spell, but I say them because I heard someone else say them before. And they don't understand what they're saying, and it makes you feel like, well, I've got to be some giant to speak to my Father. No, you're supposed to be a child in order to speak to your daddy. Watch this. It says what? And he who searches the hearts, because what? The Spirit intercedes for God's people in accordance with the will of God. Watch this. Now, here's a passage of Scripture that you never connected to the other two passages of Scripture, and you never connected to praying in the Spirit. Verse 28, your favorite Scripture. And we know that all things of God work for the good of those who love. Y'all remember that? All things work together for the good of them that are called according to God and love his purpose. Y'all know that? Y'all read that Scripture? But you didn't know it was connected to being connected. See, it's your, and watch this. These are your tools. See, how many of you know when you're connected, guess what? God says, guess what, baby? And now we know. How many of you know that the most important part of that Scripture is the first three words? And we know. How do I know? By the Spirit. Are y'all helping you? Come on, let's read. It says what? When they pray in this manner, when we pray in this manner, the Holy Spirit, here's your fill-in, then responds by imparting revelation or supernatural knowledge. Watch this. So you can impress your friends. No, to use. Ain't nobody impressed with you getting into debates about spiritual things. I don't even do that. Because it's stupid. As a matter of fact, the Bible says don't do that. How many of you know the people that can win a debate can't live it? Because when you live it, ain't no debate. Bible talked about the fact that when John got offended with Jesus, did you know that they were cousins? And he got in offense with Jesus, and he sent people. John was in jail, and he sent people, his disciples, to Jesus. And he said, our master sent us to ask you, are you the one, or should we look for another? Excuse me? Who said that, my cousin? John? And he says, well, watch this. Well, go tell John again. Because we've been dealing with this a long time. If you can't believe what I say, tell him just look at the works. How we doing? You don't need the word. You don't need to use words when you're operating in works. Does it make sense? Just look around. Hey, man, just take a picture. Take a selfie. Let's read. Here we go. It says what? When we pray in this manner, the Holy Spirit responds by imparting revelation, supernatural knowledge to use. It says there is breaking power in praying in the Spirit or praying in tongues. Is this making sense? We learned something? All right. Real simple. We're almost done. So number one was what? Prayer with fasting. Somebody say, I'm on this 21 days of prayer and fasting. Come on, baby. Number two is what? Pray in the Spirit. And watch this. And if you've never received the baptism with the Holy Spirit, when I do a prayer, when I do an altar call, right in your seats, I'm going to pray that you'll receive and that you'll be filled. I was sitting in a passenger seat of a car when I got filled. And I didn't even ask for tongues, because how many of you know he doesn't want to give you tongues? He wants to have more of you in the Spirit. And when he has more of you in the Spirit, he'll use your tongue. Come on, let's read. It goes on. It says what? So number three is what? You don't know. It's prophetic words. So number one is prayer and fasting. Number two was what? Praying in the Spirit. And number three is prophetic words. Like, oh, we can't get super deep because prophets are super deep. And I don't even know if I can even receive this because I'm not deep enough to be prophetic. And you don't even realize you are a prophet. Come on, talk to me. Come on. You don't realize that the moment, how many people are born again in this room? You've accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, then how many of you know that the Spirit of the living God that knows everything is in you? And when you allow him to speak through you, you're prophetic. How are we doing? Come on, guys. People try to be deep and miss your tool. Let's read. Come on. 1 Peter, 2 Peter 1, 19. It says what? We also know what? We also have. Read with me. It says what? We also have the prophetic message as something completely, watch this, reliable. And watch this. And many of us struggle with prophecy because we focus on people instead of realizing that God can speak to me as a prophet. And you watch stuff on TV and, you see prophets, and don't get mad. I'm just going to tell you. And prophets, oh, he read his social security number and all this stuff. And, oh, that's deep. And, how many of you know that God wants you to know that when I speak to you, you can rely on the word I gave you? Does this make sense? Let's read it. It says what? And what? And you will what? And you will do well to pay attention to it. Let's read. It says what? As what? As to a light shining in a dark place until the day dawns and the morning star rises through the prophet's mouth. Is that what it says? Y'all reading scripture? And watch this. It says, as the morning star rises, where? In your hearts. Where's the prophetic word coming from? Your heart. And watch this. And I say this all the time. And even when a prophet speaks, if it don't confirm with your heart, it's not prophetic. It's pathetic. Y'all hear me? Because somebody's trying to push something that ain't for you. How we doing? Come on, let's read. Verse 20, it says what? Above what? Above what? It says, watch this, above all, what? You must understand that no prophecy of scripture came about by the prophet's own interpretation of, are y'all hearing this? This thing ain't coming from the man. This is coming from God. And God said, and I will confirm what he said by first telling you. Are y'all hearing me? Two claps. It's all good. Come on. 21. It says what? For prophecy never had its origin in the human will. Come on. Let's read. It says what? But prophets, though human, spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. Here we go. Let's learn some things. It says what? A prophetic word can come to a person in multiple ways. Okay. So I'm going to real simple. Anybody learning anything? All right, real simple. We're almost done. Real simple. Watch this. I'm going to give you three ways in declining order, okay? So declining order means that the first one is more important or less important. In declining order means that the first one is more important or less important. In declining order, where are my students, my teachers? In declining order, it means that the first one is more important or less important. Very good. Yeah, so smart. So watch this. Let's read. It says, watch here. It says what? Uh-oh. It says, watch this. It says, through what? Through a knowing. So watch this. Here's the first and the highest form of prophecy. Watch this. Through a knowing in your spirit. When a scripture is highlighted by the Spirit or he speaks directly to you. Or even when you're, it doesn't even need to necessarily be, what will happen even in worship, because how many of you know true worship is when the word is sung. Not when you're just saying stuff that sounds catchy, but how many of you know if it doesn't come from a place of power, then it's not powerful. And so even in worship, God will just give you, and I believe it happened during worship today, God will just give you a knowing. Man, I know that was God. I know he's speaking to me. I know he's confirming something. I know I'm not gonna die. Come on, talk to me. I know stuff's not gonna be over. I know I've got hope. I know I've got a future. I know he loves me. I know I'm powerful. I know I'm a prince. I know I'm a king. I know I'm a queen. Anybody catching this? See, the highest form of prophecy is when you get a knowing in your spirit, because I know God just spoke directly to me. Are y'all getting this? Come on, here's number two. Watch this. Through what? Through a preached message that the Holy Spirit illuminates. So how many of you know that, guess what? What's happening here is important, but it's less important than what's happening out there. Come on. Because I say this all the time. What I'm saying should only confirm what he's saying. So watch this. And I know I'm going to mess with you. I don't care. But if you come in here tired, because you stayed up till 1 o'clock and you partying and you know and you watching every episode of The Oval or whatever else you can get in your spirit or power or whatever. And then you come here and you barely make it here because you was fighting with your husband and your wife all the way you get here and you're totally distracted. How many of you know that I don't care if T.D. Jakes is up here, if Jesus was preaching, come on, how about that? Because he's better than all of us. If Jesus was preaching, you still wouldn't get it because you didn't prepare yourself to receive directly from God first. Is this making sense? Come on, here we go. Watch this. So what? Through the preached message that the Holy Spirit illuminates. So watch this. So number one is a knowing directly to God. Number two is actually what I hear during a service when God will illuminate scripture. And watch this. And number three is what? By a deliberate delivered prophetic word, or when a prophet or someone who's being prophetic speaks directly to you. And I needed to share this with you because some of you think that number three is number one. But number three is number three. Let's read. It says what? By a deliberate, what? Delivered prophetic word. And watch this. In scripture, it says all prophecy should edify, exhort, or comfort. Come on, talk to me. I'm trying to help y'all because some of y'all been victims. Folks just shooting you up and, you know, but because you've been like sheep without a shepherd. How many of you know if you come here, I'm going to shepherd you? If you come here, I'm going to tell you what God says. If you come here, I'm going to cover you with the word. People just ain't going to be able to abuse you because you're being shepherded. How is this making sense? So watch this. So if somebody comes, oh, thus layeth. I said it backwards. Sus, because they're really talking backwards. Sus layeth the Lord unto you that you are supposed to do this or go here. And how many of you know? And if it doesn't edify, exhort, or comfort, it's a lie. Now watch this. They could even say something troubling, and you know, that you're sick or something's happened, or tell you what's going to happen that might not be good. But if it comes from God, God will still give you a peace. Because God's not telling me I have a problem. God's telling me breakthrough's coming. Is this making sense? How are we doing? Here we go. Come on. So watch this. So we said, what was number one? We're almost done. Y'all get anything out of this? Number one is what? No, I'm sorry. I didn't switch. Number one is through prayer and fasting, right? Number two is what? Number three is what? Watch this. And number four, we're talking about breakthrough, is through financial giving. I had to save this for four. See, how many of you know that these are your tools? I done lost all y'all. Like, say what? You mean financial giving is a tool for breakthrough? Come on, let's read. It says what? It says giving is a powerful key to breakthrough. Watch this. Why? Because all giving is a heart issue. It's not a money issue. Here's why it's not a money issue: because it ain't yours. Come on. I've been living for 48 years. I've been around people that had a whole lot of money, and none of it took them with them. I served a great man of God. I picked out his suits, and I got them now. Because he passed, and guess what? When he passed, I got his suits. Somebody's going to get my suits. You want to know why? Can't take it with you. How we doing? And so watch this. So financial giving, it's a heart issue. Because you don't own anything. You are just a steward. But your ability to give financially shows where your heart is. You are demonstrating, God, I know who the owner is. Come on, anybody who's been at the family church, you know that there's a test for ownership. It's three. Number one, did you create it? Only an owner can create it. And some of y'all think, yes, that's mine. Okay, let's go to number two. Can you maintain it or sustain it? Somebody say, yeah, I'm keeping her alive. Okay. All right. You're lying, but that's okay. Here's number three. When it dies, can you bring it back? Then you don't own it. You don't own it. And so come on, let's read. It says here, Malachi. Let's go to Malachi. Let's read. Malachi. I'm pushing the button right. I pushed the button. It just ran out. It says what? Malachi chapter 3, verse 8. It says what? Will a mere mortal rob God? Come on, let's read. It says what? Yet you rob me, but what? But we ask with all of our stuff in our clutch tightly, Lord, how have we robbed you? Come on, let's read. Lord, how have we robbed you? And it says here's the answer. He says what? In tithes and offerings. See, a tithe is 10% of the 100 that you've been given to use. The tithe is actually you in your heart showing, I know who the owner is. And watch this. And then the offering is in you deciding with God where to give beyond, how you want to give, how you want to express it. And I want to help you. This is why you know it's a heart issue. Because you know what? I said this in the first service. If God said, bring all of the grass, give me 10%. Of the grass in your front yard, bring it to the church. Y'all be like, bring in the grass, I'm bringing in the grass. Y'all, folks that don't even cut grass, you'll cut somebody else's grass. Y'all be so happy, grass will be all over the place. Woo, we bring in grass. Yes, Lord. I love tithing. It's so wonderful. But he didn't say, I'm rhyming. He didn't say bring the cash. He didn't say bring the grass. He said bring your cash. And why did he say that? Because it's connected to your heart. Here's why. Because money has the ability, watch this, not to be a god, but to make you think you are one. Come on. The Bible doesn't say that money is the root of all evil. No, it's when your heart loves it. Because you can take money and make you feel like you're an owner when you aren't an owner. Is this making sense? Watch this. Here we go. It says, verse 9, it says what? You are under a curse. And I love how the NIV says it, because it really says it more more scripturally. It says you are under a curse. Some people love to preach, you are cursed with a curse. Boy, you cursed. No, well, you're cursed because you came under one. No, God's blessed you. You've left the blessing. You've decided to leave his way, and now you're under a curse. Is this making sense? It says, why? Because you are robbing me. And then now we're saying, well, Lord, what are you robbing me of? Am I robbing God of money? No, and I say this all the time. If you really understood that the thing he's asking you to bring back to him is based off of what he walks on. Y'all catch that? The Bible says, watch this, that the streets are paved with gold. What you lie on, what you kill for, he walks on. It's transportation in heaven. So you don't realize that money is backed by gold. It isn't in this country anymore, but it was supposed to be. And so this is what we have to understand, that we have to get another revelation. So is he saying that I'm robbing him because I didn't bring the cash? I didn't bring the money? No, he's saying you're robbing me because I don't have all of your heart. And because money has become your God, I can't be your dad. Is this making sense? Y'all get this? It's quiet. It's good. Let's read. It says what? Bring the who? Bring the what? It says bring the whole tithe, because tithing is not a thing. It's a number. The word tithe is a tenth. Somebody say a tenth. So if you don't bring all the tenth, you're not tithing. You are tipping. Come on, talk to me. Hey, Lord, let me just give you a little tip. Hey, good job, God. Pat him on the butt. Give a little tip. Versus tithing is, Father, I recognize that what I have is not mine. And I'm rendering. Watch this. And here's the amazing part, that the tithe is just a representation of all of it. And God says, I don't want everything you have. I want you to be productive in the earth, but I want you to be reminded that all of it's mine. So now let's have a symbol. It's called the tithe. Is this making sense? One clap. It's all good. Let's read. It says what? Somebody say, my flesh is dying. Come on, let's read. It says what? Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be what? Food in my house. And how many of you know that when we are obedient, there can be spiritual meat? Because guess what? See, if your mind is on your money, you ain't hear nothing I said. As a matter of fact, I just offended you. But if your mind is on your God, you're getting fed right now. Oh, come on, feed me, Pastor. Oh, give me some more. And how many of you know that also when we are obedient, not only are you getting spiritual food, but then we can feed people. Come on, talk to me. Well, I got two freezers in the back there. There is an industrial kitchen that God blessed us with. We have two walk-in freezers that don't work. Not yet. Come on, Ray got it. Not yet. See, but how many of you know when we're obedient, we can build what we're supposed to build, and we can take care of the people that God's bringing to us. Is this making sense? Here we go. Malachi. Here we go. It says what? And what? And see. Somebody shout and see. He says, watch this. And see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that there will not be room enough to store it. And watch this. When we begin to operate in the spirit, God will change your status. He'll change you from being a receiver into a giver. How many of you know that when you have more that you can use, than you can use, you have to give? Y'all hear me? And do you realize that that's what God wants you to do? He says, look, if you be obedient with the tithe, I'll make sure. Guess what? How crazy. Do you know that there are people in the world that are wealthy that they actually live off the tithe and they give 90? Y'all understand me? See, because when you have too much, you can't spend it all. Is this making sense? Here we go. Come on. I lost you. Let's read. So watch this. Giving unlocks miraculous provision as well as creative ideas through revelation. Here's the last part. We'll finish next week. Let's read. It says what? It opens the floodgates or windows in some translations of heaven. Let me go back here. It says what? Giving unlocks miraculous provision as well as what? Creative ideas through revelation. How many of you know that when you reconnect with God and you realize that it's not about my money, God will give you revelation that money can't buy. Are you hearing me? Some of you can't hear from God because you're so connected to money that you can't hear the creativity of heaven that causes money to chase it down. Is this making sense? All right. We're going to close. We'll get all this next week. Here we go. Yep, give me the metacritical music. Keep going. Now, and it locked up on me. There we go. It's all good. This all the stuff we'll talk about next week. But let me end right here. It's good stuff. I had a lot of stuff for you, but y'all made this so deep. Y'all ready? All right. Somebody take me to the last scripture. Or the last statement. You read the last statement on your paper. Yeah, there you go. Watch this. Breaking ground and breaking through. Watch this. Is what happens. Watch this. When what happens? So get this. So breaking ground and breaking through is what happens when we use how many of them? All our tools. Isaiah 58, verse 5. It says this. What is such a fast as yours, what I've chosen? Read with me. It says what? A day for a man to humble himself with sorrow in his soul. It says what? Is true fasting merely, come on, catch this, I'm trying to help you. Is this thing mechanical or is it spiritual? Let's read. It says what? Is it only to bow down his head like a bulrush and to spread sackcloth and ashes under him to indicate a condition of heart that he does not have? Let's read. It says what? Will you call this a fast? An acceptable day to the Lord. See, how many of you know that God does? You don't determine the fast. God does. Verse 6, it says what? Rather is not this the fast that I've chosen. Come on, we talked about when we use all the tools, breakthrough happens. Let's read. It says what? To do what? To loose the bonds of wickedness. To undo the bands of the yoke. To let the oppressed go free. And that you do what? And that you break every enslaving yoke. Who's ready for the thing that's been on your neck to break? Verse 7, read me. It says what? Is it not to divide your bread with the hungry? Come on, giving. And what? And the homeless poor into your house? Well, watch this. And in 2020, we're going to do this. I'm going to cast some vision. In 2020, we're going to bring homeless people into this building and take care of them. Y'all hear me? We're going to take people who are on the street that don't have a dime and take care of them for a period, and we're going to mentor them, and you're going to walk with them. Come on. Why would God give us this place if it wasn't to help people? Watch this. It says what? That you cover him and that you hide not yourself. Watch this. From the needs of your own flesh and blood. God's going to break you during this fast. And there are some relatives that you have stopped speaking to. That you're waiting for them to say, I'm sorry. No, God says you're sorry. You get reconciled at the end of these 21 days or during. Come on, let's read. Verse 8, it says what? See, this is what happened. All the tools come together. It says what? Then what? Then your light, what? Then shall your light break forth like the morning, and your healing, your restoration, and the power, watch this, of a new life shall spring forth. Anybody over here receiving that? That your new life is about to spring forth suddenly. Come on, I'm almost done. It says what? Your righteousness, your rightness, your justice, and your right relationship with God shall what? Shall go before you, conducting you to peace and prosperity. Prosperity is a relationship with God. It ain't money. I know cats with millions of dollars and want to kill themselves. Let's read. It says what? And the glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. Let's read. It says what? Then shall you call, and the Lord will answer. It says what? You shall cry, and he will say, are you getting this? He's going to say, I'm right here, baby. I'm here. I've always been here. Now that you broke through and broke ground, now you can see me. Now you can hear me. I've been right here the whole time. You've never been alone. Lonely is a feeling. You've never been alone. He says what? If you take away from your midst yokes of oppression, wherever you find them. It says what? I'm done. It says the finger pointed in scorn toward the oppressed or the godly and every form of false, harsh, unjust, and wicked speaking. Come on, watch this. During these 21 days of prayer and fasting, what they've been saying about you will not hurt you. It says what? And if you pour out that which you sustain your own life for the hungry and satisfy the need of the afflicted, it says what? Then, come on, come on. Who's ready to break out? Come on, stand to your feet. It says what? It says, then shall what? Shall your light rise in darkness, and your obscurity and gloom will become like new day. It says what? And the Lord shall guide you. How often, guys? Come on. He shall guide you continually. It's my favorite word. And he's going to satisfy you. You're finally going to get satisfied. Wow, how is it amazing that not eating is going to get me satisfied? Because it's not about eating. It's the spiritual. And he's going to satisfy you in drought and in dry places and make strong your bones. And you shall be like a watered garden and like a spring of water whose waters fail not. Here's the last verse. I'm going to read it with you. Come on, read me. It says what? Make it personal. And my ancient ruins shall be rebuilt. I prophetically tell you, God is sending you back to your own mess to build it back. The very thing that you've ran in shame, God's going to bring you back in honor. And the same hands that broke it will be the same hands that build it. It says, I've laid waste for many generations. Read me. And you shall be called. Somebody say, and I shall be called. Come on, lift your hand. Say, and I shall be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer. Come on, come on, come on. Come on, some of y'all been about the streets. God's gonna use you to restore the streets. Come on, to dwell here. Did you get anything out of the word? Hallelujah, every head bowed, you can be seated. Every eye closed. Father, I thank you that your word is a promise. Your word is your prophecy. Your word is what you will and have already done. With every head bowed, every eye closed, you're here today, you heard the word, man, that was for me. And you realize, man, this isn't about things or stuff. It's about a relationship, about being able to hear him and feel him and know him and be him. And if that's you, with every head bowed, every eye closed, I'd never heard it like that before. And you realize I've never made him Lord before. You might have gone to church. You might have done ritualistic things, but you never gave him all of you. Or here's another call. Or you're here today. You said, I'm a believer. But you know what, Pastor Ted? You just opened up areas. I've lost those tools. I haven't been operating in them. And I want to recommit my life, those areas, back to God. Come on, I'm not going to embarrass you, not going to call you up here, but if that's you, just slip your hand there. Your hand is your heart. Come on, raise your heart, raise your hand. Say, yeah, that's me, that's me. Will you pray for me? I will, I will. Hands are raised all over the building. You're not looking around, you're not stirring. This is, whole message was to get you to this place. Come on, put your hands down, let's pray. Say, dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for loving me like this so much that you would give me your very best. Today I found out. Today I know that your best for me is your son, the Messiah, the breaker. His name is Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for breaking me and making me. I receive you now. Come on. And now, devil, I rebuke you. You can no longer fool me, harass me, trick me. We're through. You're finished. you've got no influence in my life. And I declare from this day forward, I am and forever will be saved, redeemed, renewed. I'm changed. I'm changed. I'm changed in Jesus' name. Somebody give the Lord a shout of praise in this place.
Amen. Praise God. You know, I Pastor Ted preached that message, obviously, the first service. And we were talking in between service, and even in the natural, it sounds very crazy when you need to build something and you don't have the proper tools to build it. You got the vision for it. You know what it is. You know what God said. You know what the promise is. But then you don't have the necessary tools to fulfill what God desires from you. Amen.
Praise God. I made a promise. I said I was going to do something during the message. I said during the altar call, it's how simple it is. If you're here and you've never received the baptism with the Holy Spirit, I just want you to open up your heart right now. Just lift your hands. Just lift your hands. Just lift your hands. You may manifest here, you may not, but you will. Say, Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you that with the same faith that it took when I received you as Lord, as Master, and as Savior, the Bible says that when they laid hands upon them, come on, and your hands are just as holy as mine. Put one of your hands on yourself. It says, when they laid hands upon them, that the Spirit of God came upon them and baptized them with the Holy Spirit and with fire. And I receive you, Holy Spirit, as my Lord, as my Savior. And now baptize me in you. In Jesus' name, so ramakando raboso, so rebakata raboso ramondo rebeki. Father, I thank you for your power. I thank you for your fire. I thank you for baptizing. 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 You can do it just like this. You can do it just like this. You can do it just like this. For people that want you to take over, to take them. The Bible says that they were all there with one heart, with one mind, and the Spirit fell, and they began to pray in power in your Spirit. I thank you from this day forward, your sons and your daughters will become a burning flame of fire that you can touch, that you can use, that you can move in Jesus' mighty name. If you believe that you receive, somebody give him a shout of praise. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Glory to God. Amen. Where there were people out there that gave their lives to Christ today. And if that's you, listen, we have connect cards. We want you to fill those connect cards out and just say that I'm giving my life to Christ. Also, there are people that receive the baptism with the Holy Spirit. Or if you want more information, you want somebody to talk to so that they can minister to you what took place just a few minutes ago, we want you to just check that connect card. And you just said, I want to know more about the Holy Spirit because I received today. Amen. And we'll have somebody call you and talk with you. Praise God. Also, on that same connect card, if you desire to join this church, you can check that I'm joining, and we will open up the doors of this church for you to be received, amen, as a full-fledged member. Come on, let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise for those decisions that were made here today. Amen. Well, we're still worshiping God. If you're in need of a tithe and offering envelope, can you raise your hand so we can see you, and we'll pass out to you one of those white envelopes. And that white envelope is designated for the tithe, as well as if you're giving an offering today. The offering is negotiable. That's where you can say, I want my resources.
Welcome, E-Fam. Thank you so much for tuning in and being a part of what God is doing here at the Family Church. In order for you to sow into this vision, all you have to do is go to our website. Go to www.thefamilychurchnj.com, or you can simply go to your app store and download Church Center, and you can find the Family Church. Or if you desire, you can text your giving. Text 843 843- 843-221. Again, it's 843-221. And you can begin to give into what God is doing right here at the Family Church. We're also excited because we're in the middle of our capital campaign. It's called our Legacy Capital Campaign. And you can give by way of our website, the Church Center app, or you can also text that giving as well. Thank you so much for partnering and believing in what God is doing here at the Family Church. And remember, the Family Church is where you belong.